business. I had a privilege of meeting a lot of the CEOs.
Who's the wealthiest person you've met?
No, I'm not allowed to talk. I was talking to
Is this South African?
Yeah, Blackfoot. That's how they say it.
Yes.
Yeah, bro. In the last summit, Kamutz.
Yes.
Yeah. So we are taking away that Mutsu syndrome.
Yeah.
Your gift before the kings. So that niching got me noticed. That also, remember, I've got a lot of energy, people say. And the energy I have, I'm a now guy. I come here, I'm loud. How are you? Did you meet Pumulo?
Yeah.
How did you guys look up? I like your shoes. I'm always, so people like that because I've got a positive energy number plate.
Okay.
Those years
deliberately.
Deliberately, so that it's noticeable. So now I'm going to soft issues now, right? Then I did soft issues of self-branding.
Okay.
Yeah, gone. Hey, now I'm telling
you big stuff. No, I come,
tell
bring
you,
them.
I'm going to tell another one. This one is $1 million one I'm going to tell.
But how are you doing? Can we start?
No, right.
We started, right? Great. How are you doing, sir?
No, all good. Just occupied.
Very busy.
Yeah, quite busy. Not operationally busy. I think I'm lucky. Very future busy.
Oh, that's interesting.
Very future.
You're
business.
Working on future stuff.
Working on future stuff. And we just completed setting up the family office now.
Family office?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
What is that, if I can ask?
So in the investment space, the 1% guys, the 1% guys, the ultra wealthy guys.
Yes. You are part of the
1%. No. I assimilate.
I took fire.
So what they do, when they're at a particular physical age,
yes,
like I'm now 50 plus, they start setting up the family office. So if you look at guys who are traditionally seen to be in the Stellenbosch entrepreneurs block, they've done this thing quite well.
Oh, the Stellenbosch mafia.
Want to get there. those guys have done it quite well. If you take White Person.
Yes.
Great book.
Yeah.
He's involved his son in setting up a family office. Americans are big on family office. So what I've always done in my entire life, I bring my 20, 15-year, 10-year ambitions in the now. So, for example, most of the stuff I've done is stuff I did and wished for them when I was staying at home in Sweden, you know. So we're in that phase now, setting up a family office. It's completely, even have a website.
Wow.
It's quite interesting. I brought my kids as the
board. Got two kids, no?
I've got three.
Okay.
Umpona, 29. Umpona, 29. Many people don't know if Umpona is a quiet one. She spent most of her time in the UK.
Wow. Studying.
Then came back to continue varsity here.
Can we move this mic closer, please, guys, if you don't mind? You can continue.
So, Umpo specializes in risk management.
She
specializes in risk management, but when you talk risk, not audit type risk, but more corporate intelligence risk.
Okay.
You know? Honor student, very smart, very bright. My pride and joy, firstborn daughter. So she's an advisor for strategy. She's responsible for Southern Africa, where she works. She works for an international company based in Cape Town. Then my daughter, Sposetu, is on her way to become the creative director. I'm not sure that you saw on Facebook, I posted her project with Vogue. She did
yes,
a
yes, I saw that.
Yeah.
I saw that. That was next level. No,
nice. We're very blessed. I mean, that's what most creative directors would wish for.
Yeah.
She got in that opportunity as a student. In fact, at some stage, I did not even believe it myself. So I went on the link to check if it's a Vogue or... You know, people
create... China Vogue.
You know, people create China organizations. So China Lopumul.
Yeah.
Is the real
one. Oh, wow.
Yeah. So she did that. So she's a creative director. She looks after our branding, our strategy, and our thinking. And then the young one is... It's 16, so we didn't put in a group because of restrictions and compliance. You remember the laws, business, kids. Yeah. So we've got to be sensitive to that.
Mm.
But we've put in the family office WhatsApp group. There we talk serious investments.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's really...
So they're directors. So are you saying you've set up a new entity, legal entity?
No, remember, family office doesn't necessarily become an entity, become an investment vehicle.
Okay.
So now I'm now talking family secrets now. So it becomes an offshoot of the family trust. So we've got a family trust.
Yes.
So we're building trust fund babies, basically.
Yes.
We're stretching the legacy of what I've been doing for them to live on with their children and their children's children. That's what family office is about. But what it also does, it consolidates our investments under one umbrella.
All right.
Right. So instead of me having a corporate board, remember my structure.
Mm.
My structure, you have Imbizo Group,
mm-hmm.
which manages the operating companies.
Okay.
Then you still have the individual operating companies. Right?
Which are quite a few.
No, it's not a lot. It's the events, Imbizo Events.
Uh-huh.
It's the transport business.
Yes.
Is the Imbicom IT, the tech company. Then there's the those are the operating companies.
Mm.
Then there are companies where now the family office comes in, when I'm invested in.
Yes.
We own a shareholding.
All right.
Which is now direct shareholding. And then there are the ones that we own through those empowerment schemes. If you go to the website nozolilecapital.africa, that's our family office website. Then there we've got those Sasolinzalo shares, we've got the MTN Zakhele shares. Then we've got shares in all the non-opcos. We put them there, the companies that are non-opcos, where the people who's in this building are not involved, where we are invested in.
What is that non-opco?
So remember, Imbizo Events is an operational company, it's an opco.
Okay.
Right? Imbizo Group is a holdco, it's a holding company.
All right.
So that's how we shorten them in the language.
Mm.
Then on top of that, then you have the trusts.
Mm.
Right? Because remember, Moss, you no longer own things in your name. Mm. We long past that stage.
In fact, that's I've got that as one of my questions here. Because the last time we spoke, you mentioned that.
Yeah.
And I think there are a couple of people that were asking about that.
Yeah.
Like, how do you structure that? Why would you put your companies under a trust? Maybe if you can educate us on that, the benefits of that.
Yeah, so it's very important if you plan for the long term that you devolve yourself as an entity and your ID name into an ownership of a company, right? So that your errors and mistakes in life do not become a liability to the company itself.
Got you.
If I have, as a person, a contractual agreement with you, and I breach it for some reason, and you would want to take recourse against me to collect the damages, whether they're material or financial, you are going to look, what does this guy own?
Yes, correct.
And then he owns these companies and they carry value.
Mm.
You then attach the companies to recover whatever costs, right?
Yes.
So, because remember, we're human beings, we're fallible. We make bad mistakes with good intentions. I mean, I always say the story of Christo Visa is one story all of us must learn.
Yes.
Good intention, but wrong decisions, you see. So you want to now...
Do you think he's really dead, by the way?
Who?
Christo
You mean not Christo, you mean...
Am I confusing him with the Steinhoff guy?
Yeah, I'll tell you his name now. I don't know. I don't know. So I don't know. I don't live in conspiracies.
Oh, you're not that type.
No. The law will find him if he's somewhere in the Seychelles or Maldives. They'll find him. So Christo... So we all make mistakes, mm-hmm. and you learn from the mistakes of the guys that you look up to.
Yes.
I look up to Christo, Mutsipes.
Yes.
So you then create this entity.
Yeah.
But also there's something important about it is that it also creates a shift where you also see yourself in the investment role capacity. So this book is no longer owned by you. The IP in the book is no longer owned by you, but it's owned by the LJ Trust, for lack of a better word. So it means that when you are not with us in the physical space, your children can still have the benefit of the value of the IP in this book. It does not die with you because it was in your name.
But why would they not have value if it's under my P2I LTD?
It's not theirs, it's your company. It's what the company's X says.
Okay.
Yeah, my children have nothing to do with my companies. Remember, companies are separate beings.
Yeah, separate unless entities. I add them as directors.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right? But the problem when you add them as directors, you also extend the risk of your misbehaviors children.
Got you.
Who were not part of those deals you were making, it isn't what you were making. So you do the trust also to make sure that your IP, the value, is not attached to you, but is attached to this thing. So it becomes a legacy thing.
Mm.
There are, of course, other benefits that a tax advisor can also give you, the benefit of how much a company is taxed vis-a-vis how a trust is taxed.
Mm.
Whether you talk about the dividends tax all those.
Yes,
so your tax advisor will then also explain to you. There's quite a lot of those guys, by the way, on TikTok who do those sort of things.
Yeah.
So it's always advisable to structure your things that way because, you know, we just don't know the eventualities of life. I talk to you now, I take a sip of this coffee, I choke, then I'm on the floor. So when you also talk at the estate level now, because remember what you do, you organize yourself in investment structures.
Mm.
So something that people should do when you have a trust, let's say you take a life cover, for an example, it must be paid out to a trust because it's easier to manage the distribution protocols of the trustees and the beneficiaries in the trust, and you don't, because the trust as a trust did, you're also not going to be trapped in paying the executor of the estate, the executor's fees.
Got you.
You know, which can become expensive because remember, the executor's fees are based on the value. So I think it's about 3.6 of the value. So if you accumulate a lot of value, you're throwing away a lot of money that should be staying in your estate because everything is unbundling your estate as a person, right? And it means the Foschini account is also there if you have one.
Yes.
You look smart. You don't look like a guy that has clothing accounts.
No, I
You're
don't.
Too smart
no,
to
I
do
don't,
those things.
I don't.
Please don't.
I used to.
Yeah, no. You're too smart to have clothing accounts. I can see that.
Why would you advise people not to have clothing accounts?
No, I mean, why should you pay those interests on stuff that you can get? I don't know what the percentage is now because I haven't had a clothing account for like 25 years. I used to work in a
club. Remember
this story?
You told us.
It's
you've got inside knowledge.
Yeah, no, I don't do. Yeah. I don't have a clothing account, and it also makes you know. I know we're digressing a bit now. You know when you do your credit profile, it's actually shocking how you can they populate data on you, and I always feel good when it says clothing. It says zero when it comes to my profile.
Mm.
And it also shows that you make good decisions in terms of how you spend your money. So the trust is very, very important.
Got you.
So what keeps me busy now is that future. Mm. You know that in the regulated age of working, I'm 12 years to go.
Mm. Which is 65?
65.
Wow.
I'm 12 years to go. So meaning I don't have a lot of time to waste. I don't have opportunity to make bad decisions. And I'm not going to prepare for that destination then. I've started already.
Mm.
I often say to my, I was talking to someone yesterday, I was such a, you know, when the aeroplane leaves an airport, you already know the landing conditions because after, just as you take off, the seatbelt light is off, the pilot will brief you, or just before takeoff, weather conditions, duration of the flight, bumpy or not. But what you also learn from flying is that as just before the aircraft does the approach, you know that's a that sound, it's a landing gear.
Mm.
So even if you were sleeping or listening to music, you're gonna feel that, you know, that it's I'm going to land, let me organize my stuff. If I was eating, let me tidy up because they're gonna come collect the stuff. If I was working on my laptop, let me close it because they're gonna tell me to close it. All those sort of things. So I think I've opened the landing gear and I'm in a stage where I'm preparing for operational exit.
From your businesses.
On the business and then focus on the family office. I made a comment on Facebook this year to say that in the events business, for example, we are mostly demanded. I'm no longer involved.
I saw. In fact, let me read out that comment because I wanted to ask you about that. This is the comment. This was on the 4th of July. I've got it right here. In my life of working for Imbizo Events, I have not missed a single conference since 2003. This is what you said. We have been hosting 5 to 8 events a year. This was the very first conference I missed, and the reason is we are shaking off the founder CEO syndrome. I want us to double click on that because that's important.
Yeah.
We are testing if these conferences can outlive me as the founder and CEO or owner. As founder and CEO, we don't separate ourselves from the business, which is very important. Your business must outlive you as the owner. The team did exceptionally well, and we are shaking off the owner. I don't know what that word is. Is it khafar, right?
Yes.
Yeah. We will carefully continue this stress test for certain conferences throughout the country and trust young and smarter people to run things for the business.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the, So that's exactly where we're at. And I've done another conference after that, another big conference after that that I did not attend. And the difference with the last one, which was the e-learning summit, it was a high-profile conference with senior government stakeholders.
Provincially.
And it was a stress test. Worked perfectly without me.
Does it, like you weren't involved in the planning or anything like that? And even...
I don't get involved in the planning because we've got project managers. I think the only one I was roped in now is the ICT summit because it was a particular reason they wanted me to get involved. So the project managers brought me in. But I don't get involved in the planning. I get briefed because remember it's a business.
Yes.
At the business level, I get briefed what's happening with that project. These are the challenges. Mm. And normally that sort of briefing is more P&L type briefing.
All right. What's it's that? What's P&L?
It's a profit and loss briefing.
Got you.
We're doing well. It's the business.
Yeah.
A briefing. It's not how many delegates we have, speakers, all let me speak to Lupumolo to get involved. It's not that sort of it's operational. It's the P&L sort of briefing. That's where I operate because I'm a P&L guy now in the business. So it's very, very important. So that one is a two-pronged thing. One is preparing the exit to see if Imbizo Events is. Remember, as long as we've had Imbizo Events, people have been coming to Mutsi's events.
Mm.
That's how they see
it.
Yes, yes, yes. Yes,
yes, yes, yes, yes. Yes,
yes, yes. Yes, yes, yes.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So we are taking away that Mutsi syndrome.
Yeah.
Because he's a nice guy, we like him.
Yeah.
He's very, it's open about his Christian views,
yes,
about whatever happens under the sun. For whatever reason, people like the work we do, he puts together great conferences. Mm. But they still like even come out. So and they're correct because I've been standing and opening these conferences since when we started. So I've exited that now. But also what's important is that we need to create space for young people in the things that we do. And I find that big South African corporations do that thing quite well. I don't want to mention companies. I mean, I can just take one company. You must look at the age of the chief operations officer for the multi-choice group. Then you'd know that how people are serious about these sort of things. You know the noise people make about young presidents in politics ministers? Some corporates are already doing it, employing young people and letting young people do this sort of thing. Lindo is responsible for our digital strategy. She's young. We trust her with it. Working with Bantu, we give feedback. There was an event that took place in Pier 1, mentioned the name of the event, so I was asking the guys, so how did the event go?
Where was this event?
I won't say.
But you already said in P.
No, there are too many events in P, but I won't say where was this one. So the guys are giving me feedback. I says, geez, the comments reflect the age of the panel. I think we must go to students and ask them for what we're looking for, because we send a team to this event because we're trying to troubleshoot something. And we're looking at wanting different ways to do it. So we thought, because the people participating there, they were largely from corporate. And the assumption is that corporate has got the latest tools of doing things, the latest
ways. Is
that the
feedback that you're getting?
So the feedback I got was that we bit ahead of them. I said, but how? Because this guy works for a huge corporate. This one is working for a huge company, etc. I'm trying to stay away from giving you hints. So I know your mind works very fast. You may figure out what event I'm talking about. So, you know, the thing we said with the guys, which was the head of comms from Bumakapa TV, says, you know what? Let's get students from Vega. Let them tell us how to do it. I think that those guys are thinking like us. That's why they're still talking banners, physical activations. The world has long left the station. Activations are digital. And we're looking for digital solutions. So maybe without blaming them, they're still thinking like our age group. And we're looking at different ways to do it. Because Bumakapa is on Free Vision, a huge app. So it's a huge app with other television stations. We're going to another huge app. So it means the shift, we're no longer advertising television as you know it. We must advertise platform one television, platform two the apps, which is a national apps, platform three the YouTube channel.
Yes.
You can't but market you, them the same way. It's impossible.
No, definitely.
That's the answers we were looking
for.
Yeah. So young people are the it.
Yeah, no, you've been doing quality conferences and events for the longest of times. Like if I think back, like as you're speaking, I'm thinking back. In my business, we've done a few events, but we've done two major ones in PE. And from both of those events, I didn't make any income.
Yeah.
And I want to get your input on this. One, we brought in Vusi. I'm sure you'd remember.
Vusi that big
Tamagwai,
one.
Yes. Over close to 1,000 people there.
Yeah.
Free event.
Yeah.
We got a few corporates to cover the costs, but. I mean, we didn't walk away with anything.
Yeah.
Then the following year, we brought in DJ Subu to launch his book.
Yes.
Also, close to 1,000 people there.
Yes.
But from a great event, successful event, a lot of value for the people. But from an economic point of view, I mean, we didn't get any return on that. And I, hearing you speak and watching what you've been doing, in fact, one of your posts, right, you were speaking about how, let me just read this. Imbizo Events is a professional conference organizer. Venues pay us commission for giving them business.
Yes.
I didn't even know that.
Yes.
So talk to us about the science of actually doing an event. I mean, you are at the stage of exiting.
Yes.
To other people that are out there. that maybe want to get into the similar space?
Yes.
Without sharing your IP,
yes.
But what do you say to them? The ABCs of putting together these large events, having multiple stakeholders into a room. What goes into that behind the scenes type of work?
I think the creative and the content part, most people master it.
Yes.
I mean, if I look at events that are being produced now, guys are even doing stuff that's better than us.
Yes.
Our Linda will tell you, we've got WhatsApp groups for various projects. We share information. You call it learning from others type sort of thing. We really deliberately go and learn. If you put an event, we go and study it. How do we do our stuff better? I think at that level, I think people do it well. I think the people do the marketing of their events quite well. To get 1,000 people, Elupumulo, it's not a small thing. It's not a small thing. So you did something right there to get an audience of 1,000 people. We often say that conference speakers, you must treat them like artists in a festival from a performance point of view, because they bring you the traffic. So how you choose your speakers,
yes,
the science
yes,
of choosing speakers. People do that well, like you've done with your two events.
Yeah.
Where I think most people have problems, it's in the P&L of the event itself. It's in the bottom line, it's in the budget of the event. The first rule I always tell people, never do an event with your money. It's the first no.
So don't put up your own money.
No, we don't. I mean, yeah, we let suppliers wait until the money for the event is fully paid.
But that's
paid.
Relationships, because you've got that relational capital
behind you. That's true. Of course, there's a bit of that. Look, some we, because maybe of cash flows, we advance the payment. We know the supplier will, the sponsor, lack of a better word, we call them corporate partners. They will pay it back and then the balance sheet adjusts itself, basically. But you never do an event with your money. The risk is too high.
You've never ever done an event with your own money, ever?
No.
What?
No, you don't do that. Those are the things we did when we started.
Yes.
That's why now we know that you don't do an event with your money. No. You don't.
Okay.
And you know what then do you do? Niching and value proposition is the first thing you must master.
Right.
Don't do what other people are doing in the events industry. It's almost that old township syndrome. Somebody starts a car wash, I'm gonna start a car wash. Someone starts a salon.
Me too business.
Yeah, I remember here in PE, somebody started a picnic, there was suddenly event, all white picnic parties all over the place. I'm like saying, hey, man, it's interesting.
Yeah.
Right? So always niche. And you probably notice, if you really think about MBA's events, you think tech events,
yes.
ICT events.
Yes.
We've
yes.
niched
yes.
ourselves.
Yes.
Because when you niche yourself, you become a solution to people who want to do engagement for that sector or demographic.
Got you.
They know for us to get the business objectives we want, go to MBAs or events, they've got the good database. Let us be present in their event. Then you must do your sponsorship packages correctly.
So you've said, don't start with your own, don't do an event with your own money.
Yes.
Niche your event. The third thing is?
So when you've finished niching your event, then the issue is that people come to you because you've niched.
Yes.
And you have a clear value proposition.
Yes.
You know, you've got a clear value proposition. Then you get into the structuring. So someone is coming to me, they want to participate. What are the terms? Which is now the packages that you do. So many people, they don't, that's the part they don't know. That's the part that is a trick. How do you design corporate sponsorship packages? And, you know, for example, today, if you go to government, you use the language sponsorship, you are not going to get that money.
Yeah.
It is a marketing opportunity. So it's how you write now your documents. You don't say to government sponsorship. It's marketing document, marketing opportunity or exhibition opportunity. You also know that government has restrictions based on the National Treasury Act on their involvement. For an example, staff will alcohol. Mm. You don't want to ask for food, for alcohol, type requests from government because their national regulation guide from National Treasury prohibits them. It becomes an audit finding when they spend on such things.
Mm.
But if you say to them, look, I'm giving you an opportunity to brand the provinces, to position the stuff that you are doing in the province. It's no different from the budget they're spending on a radio station, on a podcast, or on a newspaper for an ad.
Mm.
It comes from the same marketing budget because it's now a marketing and exposure opportunity. So it's quite easy. So they will take from those budgets and then you're able to participate. With private sector, they're a bit more flexible. It's more on the value proposition and it's more on the quantums of the amounts that you want for that specific sponsorship. So the putting together of the packages then becomes a very, very important thing that adds value.
Mm.
So I say to people, for an example, so if I have you wanting to come to an event and you want exposure. So some guys, they may say, most of them, they're rushing to present. I says, no, you're not only going to present, but I'm going to sit you in a row at the event with the high-profile guys because you're looking for strategic networking.
Mm.
But also I'm going to make sure that I can add value by giving you a gala dinner table that is strategically positioned for you to be present. Either you're coming with your colleagues into that conference or you're coming alone.
Mm.
Those that sort of value. So you need to look at all these value adds as things that are a plus to a typical participation that they may have had in another conference. Because remember, you but one of a long list of engagements that they want to do in a year.
Mm.
So you've got to then make sure that your value proposition in your package is packaged quite nicely. For an example, part of the things we do, we know we have proximity to Mpuma Kapa TV.
Mm.
We go to Mpuma Kapa TV and have a deal with them and throw the 2 million audiences of Mpuma Kapa TV in the package.
Got you.
Because now when they look at the book, they're going to say, oh, hey, I would be paying adverts at Mpuma Kapa TV for the same thing.
Yes.
Now it's all in one. You see? So I'm now saving you other elements. It's good leverage.
It's good leverage.
You see? So you've got to really think about those sort of things and not sell you only. Because there are too many conferences out there. Others are even better organized compared to you. So you've got to look at collaborating partners. You've got to find that leveraging opportunities. Bundle those and people like that. So that's very, very important. What people also don't do, when the event is done, they forget about that event and then forget about the people that supported them. We don't.
Mm.
So we do nice things that keep the relationship. Whether things that they keep in their office. Now, when I say things, I'm not talking about a stand for pens or a power bank. We don't do those things. I mean, that's what marketing departments do. But we do special, we create a collage of your involvement at the event and give it to you. You don't pay for that sort of thing. You take the collage, everybody that comes into your office, it's a breaking moment.
Mm.
In fact, the funny thing, I remember we took this collage to one national company. The guy says, I'm taking this one home to my office. Because if he's no longer working for this company, he's going to leave the thing on the wall. So those are things also. The post-event relationships are very, very, very important. Because you don't take the money, you cash, you're happy, you forget about the guys. Most especially with us, because the other important thing, send the message that you're an annual event.
Mm.
Very, very important. You're not a once-off thing.
Mm.
Guys can come back. Like ISTE Summit.
Yes.
It's 18 physical years and 19 with the year one that was virtual of COVID. It's 19 years of meeting in November every year.
Mm.
So guys budget you, they know, I mean, we were talking in a meeting now that people are looking for us.
Wow.
Because they know that November is coming, Esther Summit, you've got to be there. Let's talk to the team to give us the packages.
Wow. Wow. The issue of relationships, it's a given thing, right? The value of having solid relationships and keeping those relationships. You know, but not a lot of people talk about how you actually build relationships, especially if you're not known, right? For instance, let me make an assumption. You will tell me if I'm wrong here. You are fairly well known in the country, in the Eastern Cape. I saw a picture of you with President Ramaphosa.
Yes, yes.
You know, I saw another one with President Zuma.
Yes.
So you're fairly well known. But if I walk into the door, nobody knows Lupumlo Joker. You know? So I've got to have, you've got the advantage of your reputational capital and maybe a rich network of people that will back you, besides the strategic things that you were speaking about now, right? But if I'm coming up, no one really, really knows who I am in some circles. So how do I build a relationship? You know, if I'm not known, no one knows you. How do you actually build a solid relationship?
Hey, I'm going to tell you things now. You're going to think that, no, this one, I am shy about this thing. So let me talk the formal stuff. Then I talk the interesting small stuff, which I would put them on the theme of being noticeable theme for them. You know, if you look at, you Google my surname, Fuleni, I had the privilege of being the one who positions that surname.
Yes.
I didn't have a cousin or an uncle that played rugby for a big team. You know, we're a rugby region or soccer player. My people were just humble Christians that went to the Seventh Adventist Church, child of a domestic worker. So I'm a product of humble beginnings, family. Yes. So I was the first to then have the role of positioning the family. So what helped me, this is now the thing that people are going to think it's simple, but it is a honest fact. The Bible says your gift will bring you
before kings.
Before the kings.
Yeah.
I want to repeat this. Your gift will bring you before the kings.
Yes.
Let me break it down in business. Your value proposition is what is going to attract people to you. What did I do? Remember, I once explained that we started with clubs. Remember interview? Yeah. Then we migrated to corporate. Mm. So that transition was because I had done an analysis that in the era of 2004, then, there were no black professional events. There was no black professional event organizer. All black people that were in the event industry, they were entertainment promoters, bringing Brenda Fassie, bringing Sarafina to Centenar, and all these sort of things. Great people, great work, like of Mike Panzer, for an example, who worked with the Duhu brothers as a new bride, brought excellent work, boxing and all those sort of things. Because we were new in democracies, post-96, Mbeki is the president, we had a peak of corporate. Then I saw a niche that there is not a black events organizer. So we introduced then what was called the Black Business Summit. I niched. It then meant that I gave platform to black organizations that needed to confer and discuss issues, whether those were PE issues, whether they were procurement issues. Lastly, there were government-heavy sort of conversations with the support of the chamber. Then it was Percy and Alfred Da Costa. In fact, before Alfred Da Costa, it was Kevin Wakeford. It was the Port Elizabeth Chamber or Regional Chamber of Commerce and Industries. Then you had NAFCOC on the other side. So I provided value for business to get together because there were no such events that were taking place. But exactly what I was saying earlier on about the family office, I then started to feed on content on financial mail.
All right.
What are things happening elsewhere? How can I curate them in our region? And I told myself that I'm going to curate an event as if it's in the big cities.
Mm.
So when I do a conference, I'm going to do a conference at Dago Hall.
Mm.
I'm going to fight to be in the conference spaces. You know, my friends, I always look, laugh. You know where you have Wimpy now in the David Sturman Airport?
Yes.
The old PE Airport, as it was called. That used to be the lounge that was popular for people to sit and eat, waiting for aircraft. I cut a deal to do business networking events there.
Mm.
So people knew that there was a once-a-month networking, something put together. That's why now the Mutsi Khafar is a problem. Siyaglandoka Mutsi Manpaya Airport.
Yeah.
But, and I think that by God's grace, I then was able to attract big speakers to come at this. Mm. So I niche myself, provided a market, so to speak, for myself, meaning the gift now. I'm going back to the text, the gift putting it before the kings. And various regional people began to recognize this thing. We were not making money because the airports company that providing catering used to supply us with the food.
Mm-hmm.
But I was into this thing, office space. So those are the things that that you do. Gumutsi Mfuleni. So the name then started becoming a household name.
Mm.
And then I started getting someone like you said, I can organize Baniman to come and speak. So people started offering people that they can organize that are prominent. Remember that time it was the peak of Beatles during the glorious days of President Mbeki. Deals were just
glorious.
Happening. Oh, no, those days were glorious. I mean, if you look at the economic data, it does show.
Yes.
We were at a peak. Of course, we're a new country after Madiba. So those were glorious days. Mm. So that's then what I did. What else then did I do? Now, remember, I come from a Christian concern. I'm going to a groove, as it's called now. Groove, I think I went to groove later because I think then you know pop again, but it doesn't do any one. But that's not my background, to be honest with you. So when I left for Shin, I took my money that I had for pension. I bought a BMW Dolphin. You know those old 3 series BMW? Yeah, green, yeah, CA number plate.
Okay.
Those years
deliberately.
Deliberately, so that it's noticeable. Haman CA ngumuthi man lo. So now I'm going to soft issues now, right? Then I did soft issues of self-branding.
Okay.
Yeah, con. Now I'm telling you big stuff.
No,
now,
come,
I'm
gonna tell bring
you,
them.
I want to tell you another one. I'm going to tell another one. This one is $1 million one I'm going to tell you now. So I did the car issue.
Then deliberately as a branding thing. So you have to drive a good car.
I've got to drive a good car.
Okay.
And it must not be easy. Remember that time people were being amfunu isebecapkela la elephant. Remember suka ku CB ne? So during the time of Omre, kwachintshwe number plates. Got number plates ZPs and CE and GP has always been cool to people of Gaps.
Yeah.
Mahlale pa kula coolness.
Yeah.
Yaka CA.
Yeah.
And in the black and white plates, ne? Then what then I did was that then I chose the correct car wash to be present. Pine Gisa.
Okay.
And I will cover us as we did. Where the mix was.
You put an in Chagis?
In Chagis and your Brighton opposite the Magistrate's Court.
Okay. Yes, I see.
That was the eat. That's where the people who met her went to show off their wheels.
Okay.
And people coming home in December, they bring their wheels there. So that car wash became a networking point.
Wow.
Then Yandi Bridge, but remember Ngwasa's with Yandi Bridge, Akbanda Senyo Pride. Yeah, Kwanda, ne? Yandi Ngeta later because I got married. Umindlozi was a new bride.
Okay.
Was a double, and then later went to Kwatwes. But all the childhood friends, Amanumutsu, man, umduka Mindlozi. Yeah, Kwanda, ne? But then the other thing was that I did not confuse the market. Wherever I went, I remained corporate, dress code.
Okay.
That now I do, by the way.
No, I'm seeing you.
This guy is always in a suit.
Yeah.
All my old photos, I'm in a suit.
And your suit looked very big. As in his eyes.
Then the picture of my.
Doesn't work out.
Then the bones. That's my bones. Quite a problem. You know, there's one photo I have. In fact, I have one photo in my office. Ne? I think La Foto Delta Tensens, I event at BMF. About 2005, 2006. I think I was already dating Oman Shagaz. And he told me, I got a wife friend. I'm going to go, deep blow. So I'm going to my bones. That's the bones I sought.
Yes. But you were deliberate about that for the branding.
I must be known.
Good car, suit.
Yeah, imaging. Nanganse car wash, dinner posture.
All right.
Glad networking car wash.
Okay.
Now, if you go to my childhood friends, this is the secret now, I'm telling you now. It's kids keep on my files, man. If Uya come then colonize with it, why in the bees are Utimotse?
Okay.
And my siblings call me Motse. Kamalam look cool, I live with Kakum Motse. Nabanda Batalunko, Molo Motsunjan. Wongum no mods. Daphmas Banomanel Kamal in the Nettis. That nigga yes can walk into Banabando by our Chinchamakama. You know, you've got many DJs.
Yes.
Like DJ Fresh, that's not his name. But Abanda Balazi Kamala Kalamanyanya, that's DJ Fresh. Then I repositioned my name.
Okay. Wow.
That, man. Lomods, I think, and Utah and Donald Kamala, I'll explain. Ndaye khaya lithetha ukuthini igama lam hayi uthiwe after utata omkhulu wakho ntontontontontonto so because remember ndingumxhosa onegama lesitswana elibizwa rongo ngamaxhosa ndakhula libizwa rongo Motse I fixed my name ndathi Motse. How many Motses do you know?
You're the only one. I don't know any other. But I'm sure bakhona
manje. Do you think you can forget that?
Definitely not.
I'm an umutsi saklando kamutsi. That's how the lando kamutsi came in. So I rebranded my name ndali align correctly. Yekhona. So ngeke ngihleke nqanhleli ne childhood friends ezalwane ne. So umutsi is like a PR name now. Umotsi is like igama lam lokhulu.
So trademark it.
Yekhona. That's what happened. Then I later bumped into one or two mutsis. And the second, because we probably will be the only two in the room with a million people. Unless you go to, of course, to Gauteng, then you still find Motse and stuff like that. So those are things that I did to make sure that I'm now noticeable.
So you were deliberate about that?
I've always been. Yeah. Always been.
Yeah. I'm sure you've met people that some people can only dream of meeting. I'm sure you've had very many stories that you could share about high profile people that are well known, you know, and interactions and all of that. So I wanted to find out from you, actually, in terms of the networks that you have and the people that you've engaged with. What are some of the incidences that you can think of that you think, hey, I don't know how I got into that space or got into that room or met that particular individual? Yes. Like I was saying earlier on, pictures of you with President Ramaphosa, pictures of you, I mean, president of the country. So very high profile pictures of you, President Zuma.
Yes.
You know, what happens in those spaces? I've always been intrigued. How do you, even besides them, I'm sure there are other, if we had to look at your notebook now and go through the list, you'd have.
You know, I mean, I was reflecting on Pravin, may his soul rest in peace, recently with Pravin.
You knew him personally.
And the opportunity to interact with Pravin in private, high-level meetings where you're sitting there, you're just learning. In fact, if you go to my office, I've got a pic with Pravin and a group of other people. And it's not just other people, it's quite senior people. Mm. So your gift before the kings. So that niching got me noticed that. Also, remember, I've got a lot of energy, people say. Mm. And the energy I have, I'm a now guy. I come here, I'm loud. Mm. How are you? Who are you? When did you meet Lou Phumulo? How did you guys look up? I like your shoes. Mm. I'm always, so people like that because I've got a positive energy. I'm never dull. Mm. Of course I do. We all have moments where you feel like a squeezed orange. Mm. So people kind of like that. And so it attracts people to work with you. It attracts people to link you to a certain private conversation.
Yes.
Because you've got this value that you're contributing. And you've got this database that you have that people want to tap into.
Mm.
So I've been blessed to work with a number of people. And strange enough, this morning, you won't believe what I was, after my devotions, thinking about. I mean, I was thinking about how blessed I was to organize the funeral of Raymond Mhlaba, where I met Madiba.
Wow. So you put that together?
Yeah. Raymond Mhlaba's funeral, we were the main contractor there.
Sure.
Yeah. I mean, Raymond Mhlaba is a... first premier of the Eastern Cape. Raymond Mhlaba is a Rivonia trialist, a tried and tested leader of the South African Communist Party, became a peer later in life, and we stayed in the same street, became a neighbor.
Wow.
Did a lot of work with NAFCOC to support Omre. And I was asked to put together by, there's a department in Public Works. So Public Works does all the state prestigious events, opening of parliament, this funeral categorized as high category funerals.
Didn't know that. Yeah.
No, that one is done by, it's not presidents, it's done by the Department of Public Works.
Mm.
They've got a unit called Prestige. So they put together all these units. So I was contracted by them because exactly at that time, there's a funeral, Yaka Omre, who is the relevant service provider we can work with.
Mm.
I was recommended.
Mm.
And I was asked to go to a meeting to meet this team of people. Fortunately, I was linked to Omre at a professional level through NAFCOC and the Black Business Summit that we've done to celebrate in the times of Omre. So I met Madiba.
How was that?
I think I froze. Is it what young people call starstruck?
Yes.
I froze. Because remember, when you are the primary event organizer, you've got all access. So the drop-off point at Madiba, because he was the, not chief mourner, but by political credentials. Because remember that time the president was President Mbeki, right? So we had to be there to prepare for the arrival of the principals, so to speak. So Madiba arrived, gala walking stick here.
What year was that?
I cannot remember the year we buried Omre, but it was at the Vista Sports Center. But to give a hint, Mbeki was the president at that time, so it would have been during the second, I think the second term of President Mbeki's, I can't remember, let me not confuse the audience with the dates. So an amazing opportunity. In the planning of Omre, because he's a prominent stalwart, in the meetings, there's a number of people that come. You must stand and give update report into a Tiliyambanjan, into a Tiliyambanjan. So those are sort of things. Same as in business. I had a privilege meeting a lot of the CEOs. That,
who's the wealthiest person you've met?
No, I'm not allowed to say that. I was talking to
Is it South African?
Yeah, Blackfoot. In the dollar billionaire category.
Sure.
No, I mean...
Are there a few of those?
But you're not allowed to say those things.
In what industry?
No, I've met quite a couple in various industries, including tech. So I've met quite a couple of, I met Christo Wiese, the one I talked about in person. I was with Christo in the book launch of Ghost Becker's book, for an example.
What does he do again, Christo Wiese? Why am I confused?
Christo Galogo, remember, is a founder of PEP. He's a co-founder of PEP and the owner of PEPCO.
Yeah, the whole PEPCO thing.
PEPCO holding and then they bought Steinhoff and all these other investments.
Yeah.
A boy from Upington, Northern Cape.
Yes. Yeah, I think I was reading a few articles about him recently.
So I've met quite a number of people, and I've met quite a number of CEOs who may not be dollar billionaires, but are very wealthy and influential people. Remember also, I had the privilege of being a board member of BUSA, Business Unity South Africa, where the listed bosses go to AGMs and meetings. Mm. And at some stage, I was the vice president of BOSA. I've been really blessed to really meet these people. But what's important are the lessons from meeting them.
Mm.
You know, that be visionary, country first.
Patriotic.
Country first. These things of being pro-young people are not things that I've mastered. It's things that I've learned dealing with big guys that, you know, young people are the future. Mm. Make time for them. I mean, I was listening to one CEO on Bloomberg over the weekend. I made some notes on how a guy like me now should be doing time allocation. Mm. So these are things that you learn from these guys, yes, how they manage relationships. You know, sometimes you're in a networking session, I'm busy talking to someone else out of excitement, wants to greet. How do they put that guy on hold politely?
Yes, you know, so those
are things you also learn about how the rude ones become rude and stuff you don't want to learn from them.
Mm.
So that network was really triggered by the stuff we've done for Imbizo Events. Mm. Imbizo Events has been good to me. Mm. It's really been good to me, that business. I treat it with greatest of respect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, in dealing with the ultra wealthy people, I think at the beginning you spoke about the top 1%, right? I wrote down a question here just about wealth creation and the mindset that goes into that, and what would differentiate a wealthy person from a not so wealthy person, right? Let me take a step back and say there's a podcast I was listening to. Trevor Noah was talking to, who's this other guy? I'll remember his name. But in the conversation, they were speaking about how friendship is such a important thing that is being underlooked, and how no one is being taught on how to become a good friend, right? And then I listened to something this morning, and someone else who's an international speaker was speaking about the very same thing, and he was saying friendship is a great sign of wealth when you've got good quality networks. Yes. Not even networks, that's a bad word, but good quality friends.
Yes.
You're a wealthy person.
Yes.
Which brings me to my question. Let's leave that and talk about, you know, holistic wealth, money, you know, property, you know, being, you know, having a clear mind, being in good health and all of those things, you know, having family that loves you. Those are, for me, that's holistic wealth.
Yes.
You know, you're not lacking in any area of your life. You've been in rooms that we haven't been in.
Yes.
What would you say that the people that are the most wealthy people, how do they approach life that differs from the ones that are not so wealthy? Not sure if my question makes sense.
I mean, it does. It does. So a friend of mine was in a private jet with Tom Boardman.
Mm.
And Tom Boardman, that stage, was the CEO of Nedbank, group CEO of Nedbank. They were doing a roadshow. So they got on a private jet. They did bank management meetings in Qabega, PE then. Then they flew to Mthatha. I just want to give you a simple thing, and this thing has stuck with me to your question. So they flew to Mthatha. So he says to me, you know, I was, so Tom, so this guy, this is Gary Maxson.
Mm.
This guy is Gary Maxson that narrates the story. Great friend of mine, I must say, he's into financial services. So because he was the area manager for Nedbank for Eastern Cape that time, or regional manager, as they sometimes call them, so he was given a lift on this private jet to this meeting in Mthatha.
Mm.
So he says, but you know, when you're sitting with Tom Boardman, you think that you're going to be talking about the strategic direction of the company, what's the headcount in your region, you know, what are the nuances, what are policies? No, they were just chilling. He was just saying, look at this cloud. They were busy, you know, the era of the hype of taking pictures with the phone.
Yes.
Just took a look at this view. This, you're not going to see it again.
Mm.
And it
be
really...
present in the moment.
Being present in the moment and appreciating small things, you know. So there's a shift that a particular segment of people where they understand value of things quite differently. Sometimes this is why we get frustrated when they've got an appreciation for the environment. And would say, what does it matter? Is it a rhino or a human being? You know, those discussions.
Yes, we're
not looking at things wearing the same spectacles.
Yes.
And yet people are not saying, no, human beings are less important, the rhino is more important, but it's just a balance of looking after the things that matter in life, such as the environment, our wildlife, and our game, so to speak. So there's an appreciation of those sort of thing. But I think the most important one is how people manage their time.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, I'm a father to young girls, outside of all of this, who have human being challenges of their age group. I've got a 16-year-old is a female. I'm picking her up after later on today. She's preparing for a sleepover of the weekend at St. Francis. I must be in that moment.
Yeah.
It's a time she wants my attention. When I'm with her, I calculate which calls I take, which calls I don't take.
Got you.
Because she wants my attention, but she's not going to write me a WhatsApp to say, Dad, are you able to talk now? So I must be able to understand and be in that moment of that conversation. I also work with other young people who come from different backgrounds with different challenges. I must be able to be listening. I made a joke in the meeting this morning about body language. That is 87% of what we are saying. I've got to read those sort of things and not be focused on the bottom line sort of conversation. Because if you don't have people to do these things, you're not going to be able to do them anyway. But the other issue is just to, and it's become a huge joke in my family. So the more you change, the more you become less branded in your in the way you wear clothes and where you become visible. But you don't wear stuff that's less quality. But you move away from being known for Gucci.
Got you.
Gucci must not make you.
Yeah.
Are you with me? You don't have to wear Gucci from a sneaker to a hoodie. Those things you begin to understand that they don't really, really matter. They don't define you.
Yeah.
You don't have to be desperate to get to the level where you want material stuff to define you. You also understand why it's important to prepare now sort of for the future, why those things sort of matter. So it then influences the sort of content I consume. Thank God we have algorithms because they meet us halfway.
Yes, yes, yes.
The content I consume on TikTok, on Facebook, I get the stuff that sort of talks to a particular way where the guys at that level are sort of thinking. And I often say to people that one of the big debates is also the issue of availability. You know, I told a friend of mine responsible for a 12 billion portfolio that you are too much available. You're wanting to be the nice guy at the expense of your role. You can't be a 12 billion responsible guy and want to be available like Mutsum Flynn, who's responsible for a million. Something is just not right. Right? So you manage those dynamics of how you manage. I mean, ordinarily, you're not going to bump to Petrus Mutsepe in any airport. It's how the system works. Yeah. It's not because it's running away. It's how the system works. So you get insulated.
His time is valuable.
You also get insulated to certain type of conversations where people think. But it must not be to an extreme that you lose relevance in understanding what people on the ground are about. Yes. So you must have that balance. I guess that guys like Patrice that are heavily involved in organized business, in football, in other stakeholder events, it gives them that balance. Some guys, they go on the extreme where they don't have that balance. For me, the balance, I get it from church because I do a township church.
And you've been very deliberate about that.
Yeah. I do a township church because I still need umakhulu zathi, hey, you want that discipleship.
Yes.
I laugh, a friend of mine asked me, why don't you go to that other church because it's more your market? I says, no, that will become a stakeholder. No one will have courage to correct me when I'm doing wrong.
That's true.
Yeah.
Very quickly, NAFCOC and BMF, are you still involved? What's happening?
No, remember when I got to the business unit of South Africa phase, so I became in the umbrella body organization. So I don't get involved in the regional structures. I've long left regional structures. If you also see generally in the region, I'm not very much involved because I think that and the province, if I may add, I'm not there. You probably see me in working with the African National Congress in putting together business groups.
I think you were supposed to do something with President Mbeki recently.
Yes,
just before
during elections. Yes. Yeah. So those
that,
are the
that was going to be nice.
Yes, Shem Dzizi got the president. You saw from his, we didn't get well, and he had a trip to take out of the country. I think it was DRC, one of those peace. Keeping involvement, and he was not 12. Remember, he was from Durban. So those are the things that I do at the provincial level, and then others are linked to it. But I've long exited the regional business formations.
Deliberately?
No, it's growth.
Okay.
Remember, I've been there, late 2000s. New leadership came in. When Black IT Forum elected me to its general secretary, automatically I occupied the seat in Busa. So I cannot go back. It's almost like when you were a president, now you want to become a councillor. But it's also good that those of us who had an opportunity to play in the national role.
You bring that
locally,
wealth back.
Locally we become mentors and coaches.
Yes, yeah.
And let local guys
that's where my thinking
run
is. Yeah.
Run the agenda.
Let's talk about I'm not sure if you'll allow me to ask this, but you'll let me know.
Yes.
First 100 days, I read an article this morning, first 100 days of the GNU.
Yes.
You know, what do you make of that? What do you think about the government of national unity?
Hey, Fondin. We bonile interest rates is a hill. We bonile petrol yahl. We bonile investment drive is peaking.
Yes.
We bonile general sentiment in South Africa that is becoming positive. And the mapokopoko are becoming a cherry on top. Schools!
It's a good thing.
It's
a good thing.
It's very, very important. I think, I was saying, so I've been following, firstly, the president roadshow last week to New York at the United Nations Assembly.
I saw you were commenting on that.
Yes.
Yeah.
He met Elon Musk there on the sidelines of the South Africa Business Engagement. Deputy President is in London this week. You know, I'm a Bloomberg guy. Imagine the joy I had yesterday at home watching TV. And there's Paul Mashatile on Bloomberg.
Wow.
It was very, very special. I was reading comments this morning on Business Day Live. We're doing something right. But you know, the nice thing about the GNU government is that there's not, you find that us and them, country issues is disappearing. Everybody is now building towards the South Africa we want collectively. Yes, there are things that will concern us, like the Bella Bill absence of the Democratic Alliance Minister, but the President assured us that the Minister is committed to this thing, and we know that those were party dynamics.
Yeah.
And I don't think that we should look anyway. So I think in the main, we're doing well. The question I'm asking myself, though, at the social discourse level, what are we using with the dividend of the GNU? Because there's no longer the bickering between the African National Congress and the DA. There are no longer people taking each other to court for political posturing, right? So meaning as a country, the mental health that we now have, let's use it to come with great ideas. We no longer have to look at Spanstein, Hazen fighting with Cyril because they're now opposition. We are all now building this thing together. Let's use that energy, similarly to the energy that the Springboks are bringing to the culture, to build things for the next 20, 30 years so that our children are living in a prosperous country. So, GNU, for it. For it, definitely. And I met our minister, who's
which
a GNU
minister,
Usoli. The Minister of Department of Communication, Digital Technologies.
He's
a Democratic Alliance Minister. Also.
Yes.
Excellent
guy. He's a
guy.
Nice guy.
Great guy. Motsi, please take my cell phone number so that we talk directly. Excellent guy.
That's nice.
So those are things that, so even if I was narrow to talk basically about my sector, we are happy. And we think that also, I think the collaboration of having Deputy Minister Mondli there with his experience perfect combination for the industry.
Well, you know what I didn't like, that the outcry with most people was, I think it's Department of Public Works.
Yes.
Having the minister, a deputy minister, was more qualified.
Yes.
Than the actual minister.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, unfortunately, it comes with the package. I have a public works issue, though, I must say. Mm. And I know that it's not in the brief of our conversation, but it's very important because you are an influential platform. Mm. What do we need to do in the GNU phase? The Department of Public Works must show up.
Mm.
Now, remember, we sing a lot of visuals about the conditions of public hospitals that are terrible.
Mm.
I saw, I think it was Darren Mani did a clip, or somebody did a clip of the provincial hospital here in Qabega.
Mm.
It's terrible. We know what's happening in Livingston. Now, many people may not know that the property owner is not the Department of Health.
Mm.
It's Public Works.
Mm.
It's Public Works that contracts maintenance contractors, refurbishment contractors. It's not the Department of Health. The Department of Health is a client to Public Works. It's not Public Works, it's not the Department of Education that's responsible for the school's infrastructure that's falling apart. The school buildings belong to Public Works. We have a problem in South Africa with the condition of public facilities.
Mm. Sorry to interject. So when education gets a budget, don't they, I mean, in the Eastern Cape, there wasn't this whole hoo-ha about how the Eastern Cape government built X amount of schools.
Yes.
Wasn't that given
no,
to...
No, remember, so the Department of Education, let's take provincially, will have a school's infrastructure budget, but they hand over that property to Public Works.
The property, not the property. Budget.
No. You know, there's a project called ACIDI. Mm. It's the accelerated project, to summarize it or paraphrase it, for the building of schools after the noise of pit latrines and all this sort of thing. So the Department of Basic Education has a school's infrastructure budget.
Okay.
But the upkeep, the maintenance...
Public Works.
It's Public Works. So remember, in the property, you've got the client, you've got the landlord, you've got the person that is a tenant, you've got the landlord, then you've got the maintenance contractors.
Got you.
That is all Public Works. It's not going to be the Department of Education that's going to fix a school.
Mm.
It is Public Works. It's not the Department of Health that's going to fix a hospital. It is Public Works. These ones are end users or tenants that have vested interest in making sure that patients and learners are in decent accommodation.
Got you.
It's something that in this era, maybe with the energy that the Public Works Minister has, and the energy that the provincial public works MECs, some of them are GNU, MECs mostly are non-GNU because the ANC runs some of the province outside of, I think it's Northern Cape, as well as Western Cape. I'm not sure if the other one that's on the GNU, Gauteng is fully also another GNU one.
Mm.
So we've got to mobilize that public works plays their part so that our people go to facilities that are world-class, so that even if we talk NHI, we know that the facility of that hospital, which is under provincial administration and national administration, is proper. It's the only thing now that I think, if I were to meet a GNU minister or be in a room with GNU ministers, I would say that I think with Minister Stella Ndabeni Abraham is doing quite well. We've got set for
very
today.
Close to her, eh?
I'm very close to the vision of SMME development.
Sure.
I think it's a very important thing, and I think she's done quite well. She's completed the merger of SID and CIFA. The new board, I think, set today, yesterday. So she's doing
a
lot of work.
Are you part of the new board? Not.
No, I've asked. I want to go to school. So I'm starting school programs. I'm doing an investment course. I'm doing UCT programs. I just want to take some 6 months, really school in.
That's nice.
Yeah, so that then I can go back. But I'm fixed that boards is my future.
Mm.
But I thought, let me just take some time off and just go back to school.
Great.
So they're doing well. Pakstar was doing well. You saw the road shows that Pakstar was done, the interventions on AGOA when it first arrived. I think that the Public Works Minister is doing quite well to do an audit of the business, of the buildings that are unused, rentals that are exorbitant.
Gating McKenzie.
I let him. Unbonile, I made a comment on him. And so, no, I think I think public sector can be too stringent and fixed. Yeah. I mean, I even look at some of the, which one was the Heritage Day?
Yeah.
We were making comments. I saw the, No. It's not the Heritage. There was a recent event.
Yes,
now,
where they were bringing back the. The remains of our
fallen heroes. Yes. And they made comments. I saw the president was giggling. So he brings us the light moments in a very formal environment. Mm. And I think that understanding Gating, his heart is in the right place. I think that we need a Gating McKenzie, like we need all other ministers. I mean, remember also when the Minister of Electricity and Energy arrived to dance moves. So, I mean, these are human beings. Yeah. And I think that... Gating is we in the money with our ministers.
Yeah. I want us to talk about the ICT summit. We've got the ICT summit coming up, right?
Yes.
Before that, state of the Eastern Cape.
Yes.
What do you make of where we are as a province? I know that you're very close to the premier.
Yes.
So if you were to rate his performance, what would you say?
No, I'm not close to the premier. I'm a member of the ANC.
Okay.
So all leaders of the African National Congress, we must treat them with closeness and respect when they ask us to do certain things like these business events.
Gotcha.
Because you know that I've not spoken to the Premier. I think I last spoke to him before he left for China.
Mm. When was that?
When was the China trip? About 3-4 weeks ago?
Yeah.
Because we needed to have follow-up on certain business things. In fact, we were shocked. He gave us an hour formally in the program. We ended up speaking to him for 4 hours.
Wow.
What I think about the Eastern Cape. So if you recall, during the time of Premier Phumulo Mosoale, I wrote a comment commending him about the national road infrastructure. Now, Phumulo, if you get into Tsetsekama Sarapatman, you get out towards Kokstad, towards Durban, well, let's agree that the commercial driver of logistics, driver of tourism, infrastructure is excellent.
Mm.
You do have problems if you take Eastern Cape with the road to Addo, which they're trying to fix now, where we've got the citrus and the tourism corridor. You know that road that joins, connects to Motherwell. Mm. The road from Ndlambe towards Buffalo City, post Fish River.
Mm.
There's some work that needs to happen on that road, but a huge portion of that road infrastructure is excellent.
Mm.
So I think them driving the because you need the roads to push logistics, to push economy, you've got those sort of things that I think they've done the boxes. The road infrastructure to villages is coming on quite nicely now to connect rurals with proper road infrastructure. There are some who still don't have. The bridges that are being built to make sure that access on bad weather conditions to rural communities is proper bridges that are being built and proper engineers are being commissioned. Locals are invited to participate in those things. Those things are coming on quite nicely. My concern, though, is around what's happening in our ports.
Okay.
I'm not sure you're following the debate that ships are no longer able to deliver fuel for storage in Gqeberha because the condition of our ports is terrible.
Mm.
If you drive between Gqeberha and Buffalo City, you see all these fuel tankers on the road moving fuel up and down.
Mm.
And someone was even saying that Nelson Mandela Bay people, it's a big debate actually, must follow it. Nelson Mandela people must not even benefit for the price adjustment of the fuel prices now because we're not contributing. People are battling to have access to petrol and diesel. So we need to sort the issue of the port.
Mm.
But also we need to support the initiative by the TNPA to have the head office based here in Gqeberha. This issue of the head office in Gqeberha is very, very important. It's going to stimulate the economy. It's going to move the property values up because if now if people who are buying properties, bring families here, private and public schools are going to be happy. people who are suppliers for logistics company are going to be happy, and the establishment of our airports will have the capacity to deal with industrial and logistics. You know, the railway line to transport the Ford vehicles from Pretoria through the port of Ngqura into the international markets. Those things are beginning to move. We need to fix our ports, because if we don't do that, we stuff. Remember, the port of East London is not a real port, it's a river port.
Mm.
So meaning you have a particular depth of ship that is not able to move from out of that one. The second thing we need to do as Eastern Cape citizens is to support investment opportunities. I think that we missed the ball when the Qataris were here to make investment in the Eastern Cape, and they landed in Bulembu, and we criticized that whole sort of thing. You know, those where you're going to chase investors. Investors are coming to your province. You do not have the size of an airport for them to land. You've got an unused international airport in the scale of Bulembu.
Mm.
People come there. We criticize it as people of the Eastern Cape. There was livestock that was being shipped out of East London port. I'm not sure
I saw that.
Going into in the international market.
In the thousands
to benefit emerging farmers, establishing farmers. You know, with the biggest beef supplier in Africa, Eastern Cape, right? If and these things must move through them. We're busy criticizing about the SPCA must come and investigate these things. We're turning off investment by being said. The other issue, the issue of the issue of the mining opportunities, the issue of shale in the world coast. We have to be understanding in the Obana as huge investments when they come. Are we managing conglomerates' interests by keeping away these investments in the name of being environmentally friendly? Remember my view on environment I mentioned earlier, that we're pro-environment? Or we are just delaying the economic growth of the Eastern Cape? You saw the stats about 2-3 months ago. Highest unemployment, highest youth unemployment.
Yeah.
When our people go to the Western Cape, they're called refugees.
Mm.
Where must they go if we are now driving and talking negatively about these investment opportunities? We have to corner, all of us, become ambassadors of investment opportunities. There is nothing absolutely wrong when we see that Shell is going to mess our maritime and oceans, that to say to Shell, what do we do to achieve what you want to do, which will create jobs without damaging the environment? What is the post digging and looking for oil and gas that is going to be done when you found your deposits to make sure that we retreat the environment to its normal? Those are the conversations we must have. We must not have these liberal lobbyists kicking away so that Eastern Cape becomes a nice retirement, clean Amazon in the world coast, and yet the people, the locals, are living in squalor, and they can't sustain themselves, because we all know the grant money Cyril gives our people is not enough. So, and there's nothing that can be enough that government does, because government is not an employer, right? So the little government can do, we must support it by promoting and supporting huge investments in the province. Those are things that I think I've got a gripe with us as citizen people. You know, if you have a premier of the Eastern Cape is doing something wrong, I think there is an opportunity to engage. I know the premier quite closely. He's an amicable guy. He's a no fancy access guy. He's easy to access. I sometimes say to him, I think you are too accessible.
I've been trying to get a meeting with the premier for over 2-3 years.
Directly or through his people?
Through his people.
No, you must ask Pumakapa TV how they battle with interviews sometimes with the premier. Remember, people, you have always gatekeeping, right? But you know what? You can actually say, ask the premier, send the premier WhatsApp. Premier, I want to invite my podcast to talk about the Eastern Cape. You would get more response, and obviously he will regularize it through his comms people. But he's a responding guy. But technocrats are technocrats. I mean, even myself, I sometimes have gatekeeping. But because I've got access to it, then I just bypass the person and I talk to him directly. So he's an accessible guy. So we must criticize him when he's not doing well. But don't play politics with the face of your province, who must be your international ambassador for investment, because we all live in a digital village. We see what the citizens of the Eastern Cape negatively and positively write. I don't say we must be, yes, Mabuyane people. Yeah. But I'm saying we've got to appreciate what Cyril is doing and support.
Yes.
We've got to appreciate what our ministers are doing and support. We've got to appreciate what our premiers and MSCs, mayors and councillors are doing support. Where there's a room to criticize, we must provide that constructive criticism.
ICT summit. You've got the ICT summit coming up. Again, I mean, when we started off, we started off by saying you've been doing this thing for a long time. For people that don't know anything about the ICT Summit, what is it? What can we expect? By the way, before you answer that, do you pay your speakers for ICT Summit? Or any of your speakers for your events? Do you pay them to come and speak, or do they come and speak for free?
You know, many... So the profile of our speakers, they come directly from the industry. So you will be... we will invite you via your podcast company.
Got you.
So your podcast company would then say, company policy says we pay for ourselves. Then you've got the guys that are doing NGO work. Then those guys we pay because they do not have the means to fly, accommodate themselves. So we pay those guys. Then you've got guys who are prominent names. I won't mention names. Maybe I do because they're good examples. Take Prof. Pakeng, the former UCT vice chancellor. Yes. Her honorarium goes to a charity of her choice. Wow. Right? So that's really how we manage it. Government people, we can't pay. As you know, that it's part of their business to speak at these conferences about government policy and programs. So yeah, we do it. So it depends who the speaker is. So there is an element of those who are in the payment criteria that we pay. But guess where we are now? We are now being told that speakers must pay us to come speak at our conferences. Why are we not charging them? It's an interesting dynamic. That's what happens in other conferences.
Is it?
Yes.
Look, because of the platform. And
It's a huge platform. Wow. You're wanting to influence a conversation, whether it's a policy conversation or it's a product conversation. That's what happens now in the big conferences. People pay to speak at a conference.
Are you going to make them pay or not? Or are you still thinking about it?
No, we're not there yet. We just, look, to your question, what are we all about? It's about lowering the barriers of access to tech information.
That's nice.
That's what we do, but we do it in a managed way so that we don't have regrets because we've not made money after the event. The event has to remain profitable.
Yeah. So when is the ICT Summit?
The ICT Summit is the 19th, from the 19th. November. So we'll start on a Tuesday with golf, Wednesday summit, and then Wednesday evening is the dinner, the 20th. Then the last day is the 21st with the summit. And the 21st is our big day because it's focused on development. It's Innovators Day. And then we do the creative tech industry. Remember, the summit has brought big names. Editors of Sunday Times, editors of Herald, Dispatch, as business analyst, Luis Obalas from SABC. So it's a big platform, the creative tech. Last year we worked with all the influencers. Remember, it was after Betusile won the metros.
Yes.
We brought influencers to talk, have a conversation about how influencers are leveraging on technology. What are the things that they want us to fix so that then the industry deals with those matters. You can see that the telcos now are trying their best to have different packages that seem like lowering the cost of data. Because, you know, people consume you and me and Mpumakapa online, so it's a data issue. I even laugh when I talk to Mpumakapa. No, you can download it when your network was as Wi-Fi. Because, you know, storage and data cost is important to people. So that's really what we want to do this year. We're looking at what are the trends, what really is artificial intelligence.
So AI is a big thing this year.
Excuse me. So AI is going to be a big conversation. And we look at other trends, the future world of work. People are still hybriding. Mm. I call people in call centers, you can hear them, they're taking the call from home.
Mm. That's a nice topic, future, the future world of work.
Yes, yeah. Yes. So those sort of conversations. Are we also remember now the other thing that is quite big, it is to connect the independent internet service providers, the ISPs, into the Wi-Fi economy.
Okay.
Because a lot of, we've been able to get a lot of them licensed now, but now they must get the deal. So there is that project SA Connect, where they're now given various sites for them to deploy fiber, whether it's fiber or a bit of a dish satellite, so that communities are connected. And the privilege of watching this podcast is not for those who are in areas with broadband infrastructure.
No, Mr. Mutsa, thank you so much for sitting down with us for this conversation. You know, you are one person that people, I think, should look up to because of the work that you're doing and because of the heart that you have for young people.
Yes.
You know, and, you know, people talk. I talk to a lot of people about you.
Yes.
What do you think, you know? So I've got the benefit of hearing what people think.
Yes.
And majority of those sentiments are good sentiments.
Yes.
So I think you're doing well. An interesting journey, interesting stage of your journey if you're thinking about exiting now. So I'm looking forward to seeing how that will play out.
So probably next time we talk will be progress on the process.
Yeah. So my last question would be your favorite books. What are you reading at the moment? Or maybe what are you reading at the moment? And give us your maybe top five favorite books that have reshaped your perspective on life.
So I'm going to flip it differently now.
Yes.
What am I watching at the moment?
Okay.
First thing is the Air story, Nike Air story.
That's on Apple.
That's on Prime.
Prime.
I watched it.
It's very nice.
I think it's a good story for people to watch.
No, I watched that.
The important thing about that story is the journey of entrepreneurship. Remember, Phil Knight started Nike, and then it became listed. Now he's got a board, so he cannot just do things.
Yeah.
He must account. Some of the people in his teams are the people he started with. They're frustrated now by the red tape of being listed.
Mm.
The big story for me, though, is the part where Michael Jordan's mom, Dolores.
I really enjoyed that. Well, she negotiates.
She negotiates the role of parents into the futures of the children. That's the big story. That's a nice takeaway for me. I think really want to, it's a nice thing to watch. You can't sleep. You've got time. It's not too long movie to watch. It's called Air. It's on Prime. The second one to watch is Ferrari, the story of Ferrari, Enzo Ferrari.
Okay.
It's another powerful story I read. So you would see the trend of my recommendations now about family values and family structure, because those things matter to how we see you. Because how you deal with family aspects, how you deal with the growth of your children is a reflection also of how your business operates and how it's perceived. Because remember, ethics about a huge part of what we do. The story of Enzo is an interesting story. Enzo starts Ferrari. He starts this thing with his wife. Wife is in partnership. They've got the son. The son passes away. Enzo's got the small house man, Makwapeni. They have a son.
Yeah.
The son does not die. Ungoskazwake. Is hurt that he's not grieving enough. His son, he's taken his energy to his son's kamongi, right?
Okay.
And there's this tension in the family. Enzo needs to balance family dynamics and business dynamics. At this stage, Ferrari is not performing well. He's being beaten by Maserati left, right, and center. The costs of engineering to put together Ferrari are high. And they had a terrible accident where, in one of the races, the car flips. You know, in these races, almost like the traditional Spanish races. You've got people.
If
on
you
the
tell
side.
Them everything, they're gonna feel like they've watched.
So it's a very, very good story.
Yeah.
Look at the family dynamics. That's what I
attracted you.
That's really what attracted me, because that's, I think maybe that's where my mind is at. How do I adjust my family life properly? So it's the two ones that I really.
We Crashed. Have you watched that?
Not yet.
You should watch it.
Is also on?
It's on Apple TV.
We Crashed.
We Crashed. It's about the story of the founder of WeWork.
That's the one I want.
Yeah.
That's the one I want. Very, because I crashed recently.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's a very, very good series.
We Crashed.
Yeah.
Crashed, WeWork. Okay.
Yeah. It's a very good one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's really what I wanted to recommend. Books. I'm still reading Dambusa's book on how board works. Because my mind is there.
Dambusa.
Dambisa Moyo is a Kenyan that's in the US.
Okay.
Sitting in boards of many listed companies.
Wow.
Chevron being one of them.
Wow.
So,
you wrote a book on that?
She wrote a book. It's a beautiful journey on what she's doing. I'm reading a book on ShopRite by Whitey. That whole story of ShopRite. I'm finishing off that book.
Yeah.
So I still keep myself a book. But the strange thing, I'm going back also to old books, because I think the Phil Knight story, after watching the movie, I went back to that story, because there were certain interesting things that I wanted to.
Here's an interesting thing. I just finished reading a book. I'm sure you'd know it, Animal Farm.
Yes.
I read it a long time ago when I was in school, but I reread it now, and I thought, man, I think all politicians should read that. Have you read it? Do you know the book?
I've read, yeah. That one and Remove My Cheese used to be my favorite books of the old copies. No. Yeah.
Thank you.
So thank you so much.
No, thank you, sir. Thank you for having
thank
us.
You.
More life and more success to you and your businesses.
I must say, I enjoyed your interview with Bantu Holomisa.
Oh, you know what happened? Let me say that before we finish. He didn't actually want to do the interview.
Really?
He came. I intentionally called him to come to the pellet doctor.
Yes.
Right? Because he was around. When he got there, he said to me, no, it's too cold here. It's too cold. Then I explained the creative intention. I wanted us to be outside of this place. It's significant. Yes. Then he said, oh, okay. You know?
It's but very then, fatherly.
Yeah, yes. Then halfway into the interview, he said, no, I enjoyed
that
No, thanks a lot.
But it's very fatherly.
No.
I enjoy it. Many people, I think, if they watched, I think I recommend you watched Lupumlo's interview with General.
Yeah.
There's a side of him that people don't know. Very fatherly side.
Yes.
Yeah. And his stories with Matiba.
Yes, yes.
I really enjoyed those.
No, that,
so I watch your content.
No, thanks. That's you know. Thank you to Pumulo and the team that put together the content there.
Yeah.
But thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
So he's mic too. How is that coming through on your side?
Oh, no, God. Nice. Nice.
No, nice.
Yeah.
All right. Otherwise, thank you for this. Thank you for your time. Yeah. I know your time is very valuable. Yeah. I've got an updated version of the book for you.
Thank you.
I'm going to leave you a copy. In fact, you can grab that one. That's nice. That one will be yours. Nice. But how are you doing, sir?
I like the cover.
Yeah, it's a new. We got a guy. All of this has been done locally. We got a guy, Unati. I think he works at Boomtown now, who designed the cover for us.
Just upi u kabizu itumeleng. Mbomakapa TV. There's a lady itumeleng. I asked her to reach out to you. Because I said the Funguense event, né?
Yes, sir.
For all the young, lack of a better word, black authors.
Yes.
Like a book fair.
Yes.
So I asked Itumeleng to put it together.
No, she hasn't reached out.
Yeah, that's why. And I saw her walking in when I was in an office.
She hasn't
reached out. She's written a book on poems.
Oh, nice.
So I was going for the support of her book. And I'm saying to my mailman, I see all these guys also
writing. Yes. Yes.
Get all our guys.
Yeah.
We put trestle tables here.
Yes.
Make a nice cheese and wine.
That'll
you bring TV. Guys bring books. We buy. We network. We socialize.
Yes.
We can do this thing once in 3 months.
Yes.
Yeah.
In fact, the university wanted to do something similar.
Yeah.
NMMU. They reached out to me. So that would be great.
Yes.
Because I think they've got about, there's another guy who wrote a book on something that has to do with the Mets.
Yes.
Another young chap.
Yes.
And there's Oluwam.
There she is.
Oh.
She wrote a book on poems.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Banyan
Kamla?
Itu Meleng. Itu?
It's Itu.
Where's our book project? What does that mean in practical terms? When is the date?
Not yet decided.
No, then it's not coming if there's no date. Sorry to ask this question in front of people. But the spring, driver in Dobana, there's a book in front of me, and Yakumbula listening to Tangas. He's one of the guys.
Okay. Amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll
exchange
to you later.
Details.
We'll talk to you later.
Thank you.
On
the spot.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but I need dates, Ituna, on a very serious note.